Hello, I'm Lars Jeuken, reader at the University of Leeds. In this podcast, we will see how enzyme inhibitors work and why this is important for pharmacology. First, what are inhibitors? In short, inhibitors are molecules, usually small organic molecules, which stop enzymes from performing their catalytic function. There are various ways in which inhibitors stop enzymes from working, and we will look at some of these examples in this podcast. I will also give some examples why inhibitors are very important in our daily life. Remember lysozyme? In the podcast, How is the shape of an enzyme related to its function? I explained how the substrate of lysozyme binds into the binding pocket of its enzyme. We saw that the substrate of lysozyme is peptidoglycan, and that in order for peptidoglycan to fit into its binding pocket, it had to change its conformation. By changing the conformation of peptidoglycan, the enzyme is able to catalyze its breakdown, thereby killing the bacteria that rely on peptidoglycan. Now, what would you think happened if a chemist could make a molecule that looked very much like peptidoglycan, but chemically could not be broken down because a vital bit of the chemical is different from peptidoglycan? Indeed, that chemical would bind to lysozyme exactly at the same spot, but could not be broken down. Because this chemical would bind to the active site of lysozyme, the normal substrate would not be able to bind anymore. Lysozyme can thus not break down peptidoglycan when this molecule is around. This molecule is said to be an inhibitor. Because the inhibitor, like the substrate, can leave lysozyme again, the substrate and the inhibitor have to compete to bind to the active site of the enzyme. This inhibitor is known as a competitive inhibitor. Some inhibitors do not bind to the active site of an enzyme, but we will not discuss them in this podcast. These other inhibitors are known as non-competitive inhibitors. Remember, I showed you the protein structures with a red substrate bound into the active site of lysozyme? Well, I lied a bit. It wasn't peptidoglycan that was bound to the active site. Instead, an inhibitor was bound to the active site. Solving a structure of an enzyme takes lots of time. If we would bind the substrate to the active site of the enzyme would break down the chemical, and it would not be possible to solve the structure. So this is why we often bind an inhibitor to the active site of an enzyme when we study the structures. Since inhibitors look a lot like the substrate anyway, these studies still tell us how the enzyme works in real life. Now, I explained before that in order for a substrate, peptidoglycan in this case, to bind to the active site, it has to change conformation. The conformation of a bound peptidoglycan is called the transition state. What would happen if we slightly change the inhibitor structure so that it does not have to change conformation anymore before binding to lysozyme? In other words, what would happen if the inhibitor looks more like the transition state of peptidoglycan? Well, the answer is that the inhibitor will bind even better to lysozyme than the natural substrate. This can be understood by the fact that this new inhibitor fits even better into this cleft. This new inhibitor is known as a transition state analog. Because it binds better to lysozyme than the natural substrate, it is a better inhibitor. And many inhibitors are transition state analogs. Now we know the general principle by which inhibitors work, let's look at some inhibitors that have applications in medicine. We will look at various examples. The first is penicillin, a very common type of antibiotic. We all know that antibiotics kill bacteria and thus helps us to treat infections in the human body. Penicillins inhibit an enzyme that is called transpeptidase, which links various strands of peptidoglycan together. By linking peptidoglycan strands together, the cell wall is stronger, and thus the bacterium is more resistant to all kinds of environmental stresses. We have already seen that without peptidoglycan, bacteria will die. Because bacteria grow, the crosslinks in peptidoglycan are continuously broken by the bacteria and remade. Transpeptidase is required to continuously remake these crosslinks. Without the bacterial transpeptidases crosslinking peptidoglycan, the bacteria will die pretty much in the same way after treating them with lysozyme, as we've done in the other podcast. Transpeptidase crosslinks two chemical groups from peptidoglycan together, and one of these groups is called diala-diala. When you compare the chemical structure of diala-diala with that of penicillin, you can see they are very, very similar. In fact, penicillin is a transition state analog of diala-diala. If you look at the structure of the enzyme transpeptidase with penicillin, you will notice that the inhibitor will neatly fit into the active site of the enzyme. However, penicillin is even more potent than most other enzyme inhibitors. When transpeptidase binds penicillin, a chemical reaction takes place. And this chemical reaction will make sure the penicillin is permanently bound to the active site of the enzyme. Transpeptidase is thus permanently inactivated. Even when you take penicillin away from the enzyme will still be inactive because the penicillin cannot leave the enzyme. It's also important to realize that in our body, we do not use peptidoglycan for ourselves. We do not have enzymes that look like transpeptidases or perform a similar function. Because enzymes and inhibitors are so very specific, like substrates, penicillin has hardly any toxic side effects to humans, but can kill a wide range of bacteria that rely on peptidoglycan for their survival. The second example is a drug that is used to fight AIDS. The drugs are administered to patients who are HIV positive. HIV is a virus that contains RNA. After the virus invades one of our cells in the body of the patient, the first step it will do is convert the RNA to DNA. After this DNA is integrated into the cell, it is used to produce more viral RNA and thus more virus particles. In the last step, the particles are released by the cells, which can then invade other cells. The process of converting RNA into DNA is called reverse transcription. And this task is done by an enzyme called reverse transcriptase. Our cells in our own body do not use or require reverse transcription, and thus do not have an enzyme that is called reverse transcriptase.